Okay, now, at this point, we're ready to look at the other type of image. Images that are formed by refraction, not reflection. In other words, we don't use a mirror anymore. We use what's called a lens. Okay, a lens. To start with, let's discuss first images formed by a spherical refractive surface. Okay, so I don't have two surfaces like a lens would. I only have one surface. So on this entire side is made of, say, glass. Okay, and that entire side is air or vacuum. Right. So I don't truncate this piece of glass with another surface, as I would do later in the case of a real lens. So this is just like, you know, a semi-infinite large piece of glass. Okay, but it's got a spherical shape. It's a spherical surface on this side. Okay, spherical surface. What I want to know is if I put an object here. Object O, say a point object for simplicity, I want to know where the image is formed. Okay, so I have a beam of light coming in from here. After getting refracted, it's going to get into the glass, okay, and it's going to hit the axis at that point, forming an image I. I want to know how far is that image from this point, the vertex. That distance is called Q again, and this object distance to the vertex, of course, is called P. What I want to know is how is Q determined in terms of P? And of course, the radius of curvature. And of course, the index of refraction, N1 and N2. That both, of course, will make a difference. So this is a first example of image formed by refraction. So you need a transparent material, okay? So light can actually go into the second medium instead of getting bounced off like a mirror. All right, now, you got a beam coming in like this, makes an angle theta with this reference line. Okay, and I start from the optical center, which is, again, the center of the spherical surface. I draw a line. This line, of course, is the normal line. Okay, so theta 1 is the angle of incidence. And after getting refracted, the beam is getting bent, so it goes that direction, makes angle theta 2 with the normal. Okay, so obviously theta 1 and theta 2 should satisfy the Snell's law of refraction, which is which is sine theta 2 over sine theta 1 equals to, what's that equal to? N1 over N2, right? N over N2. Okay, I'm going to make an approximation as I always have been doing here, and that is a small angle approximation or near axis approximation. I'm assuming that these angles, alpha, beta, theta 1, all these are pretty small. In other words, I shoot a beam that doesn't really meet the refract surface at a point that is very far away from this optical axis. Okay, so point P is pretty close to the optical axis compared with the radius of curvature. So all these angles, theta 1, theta 2, alpha, beta, whatever, all these are very small. So therefore, I can replace sine theta 2 with roughly theta 2 and sine theta 1 with just roughly theta 1. And then I have theta 2 roughly equal to N2, N1 over N2 times theta 1. Okay? And we often make one of these two ends equal 1, because that's the most common case when we have air on one side and glass on the other side. So I can often take N1 as 1, but of course you don't have to. Okay, so that is one consideration, Snell's law of refraction. And with that, I want to find what Q is equal to. Okay, now take a look at the geometry here. What's left is really just some geometrical consideration. In order to find Q, I'd have to know, look at this right angle triangle here, okay? I have to know what D is, right? I have to know what D is, and if I know what D is and I know what Q is, then I have D over Q is what? Tangent gamma. This angle is gamma. And since gamma is very small, it's roughly equal to gamma itself. Tangent gamma is roughly equal to gamma itself, so I would be able to write such an equality. I have D over Q is roughly equal to gamma. Okay, I want to also get P involved. Look at this right angle triangle. I have D over P is roughly equal to, is actually exactly equal to tangent alpha, which is roughly equal to alpha itself. So D over P roughly equal to alpha. You can write tangent alpha, then approximately equal to alpha. Okay, now, of course, I have to get theta 1 and theta 2 involved. So, take a look at theta 1 and theta 2. How do they get into the picture? Now, you notice in this triangle here, I have theta 2 on this side and have gamma on that side. If you add them together, okay, you get beta, don't you? Okay, theta 2 plus gamma is not equal to beta, but beta is related to R and D. So this is how I get theta 2 involved. So theta 2 is equal to beta minus gamma. Beta minus gamma, and beta itself is roughly d over r. Really, I should say tangent beta is d over r, but that's roughly equal to beta itself. So that's roughly equal to d over r, and then minus gamma. Okay, let me combine these equations together. See what I get. Theta 2 equals to d over r minus gamma. Gamma itself is d over q, so I can write this d over r minus d over q. Right? But theta 2, on the other hand, is also n1 over n2 times theta 1. So you write this as roughly n1 over n2. Theta 1, but good, that's theta 2. Okay, now, one last point. I have to get alpha involved because that has p in it. How is alpha going to get involved? Well, if you take a closer look, if I draw a line that's parallel to the optical axis, what do you see? That line cuts theta 1 into two parts, right? This part and that part. This part, the upper part, really is the same as what? As beta, right? Isn't that true? And the lower part is the same as alpha, right? Isn't that true? So really, theta 1 is alpha plus beta. Okay? Theta 1 is roughly alpha plus beta. I can write this as, it's exactly alpha plus beta, not roughly. So that's n1 over n2. I can write this alpha plus beta. Okay, alpha plus beta equals theta 1. And I know what alpha is. Alpha is d over p. And beta is d over r. Okay, so now I have this thing equals that thing. You see, there's a d. I can drop that off, and then I get an expression which contains p, q, r, n1, and n2. And that is what I need in order to find q. Let's clean this up a little bit, okay? So I drop out d, then I have 1 over r minus 1 over q equals n1 over n2, and then what? 1 over p plus 1 over r. Okay, what I need to do now is to find q, okay? What I'm going to do is I'm going to move p and q together and move the two r terms together. And so the two r terms I can write as, okay, 1 minus n1 over n2, and then 1 over r, right? I basically move this term over to the other side. And then I move that 1 over q to this side, then I get n1 over n2, 1 over p, and then plus 1 over q, okay? This gives me an expression relating p and q. Now finally, if I multiply everything by n2, I'll get my final result. If I move everything on the last equation by n2, I get, let's put the right-hand side first, okay? This is n1 over p1, n1 over p1. And then that one is n2 over p2. What's that equal to? That equals to this side multiplied by n2. That's n2 minus n1 divided by r. Okay, this is what I'm looking for. All right, So when Zeno P, actually I should say not P1, I should say Q. What am I doing here? This is Q and this is just P. Okay. So again, N1 over P plus N2 over Q equals N1 minus N2 over R. This is the equation I'm looking for. Once I know P, I can find Q. Okay, once I know where the object is placed, I can find where the image of that object is. And you can see here, this result has nothing to do with this angle alpha. As long as alpha is small, okay, that means all the near axis beams will eventually, coming from the same object, will eventually converge at the same point on the same optical axis. So this will be the location of a clear image point for any object placed on the optical axis. Okay, and we can use this in many, many ways, but in particular, we can look at a special case when R equals infinity, which means this surface is flat. So for example, I can look at, say this side is water, this side is air. Okay, so if I place an object somewhere on the somewhere in the air, where is the location of the image formed by that object inside water, or basically maybe a flat piece of glass slab? Okay, and that you can easily do by setting R equals infinity. When R equals infinity, the right hand side is zero, right? The right hand side is zero, so I get N1 over P plus N2 over Q is zero, which means Q is negative. Now we all know what a negative Q means now. Okay, what does the negative Q mean? The negative Q means is that you have a virtual image, okay? That's what a negative Q means. And exactly what does the virtual image mean? Virtual image means this is where when a whole bunch of light beams are divergent, okay, when you extend them backward, they appear to be from a certain location. That is the location of a virtual image. Okay, now, here, let me show you. R equal to infinity, okay. You have N1, N2. You can say this is water, this is air, or even vice versa, this is air, this is water. It doesn't really matter. Okay, I got an object here, okay. I get an object here. This object projects beams in all directions. Let's say for the sake of clarification, let's say this is water and this is air. Okay, this is air. So basically N1 is greater than N2. So you see that is why light coming off would diverge, because this is optically denser medium, water. This is optically less dense medium, so it's going to diverge like that. Okay, so in this case, you put an object somewhere below water, okay, somewhere below water, and you want to see what the image is. You see, obviously, they diverge, okay? The light rays diverge, but if you extend them backwards, they appear to originate at this point. This, therefore, is the location of a virtual image, okay, a virtual image. And this is P, from here to there is P, and from here to there, this is Q by definition. Okay, according to our equation, N1 over P plus N2 over Q is zero. R is equal to infinity. So Q is negative N1 over N2. Actually, negative N2 over N1. Q, P, right? Okay, so this is Q. Now, in our case, N1 is greater than N2 because this is water, that is air. So N2 over N1 is less than 1, okay? Less than 1. So this factor here is less than 1. It's less than 1. That means, first of all, Q has a lower absolute value than P, right? You see, indeed, you see, this is Q, and that is P. Q is shorter than P. Okay, so that means an object, the image appears to be closer to the surface. So if this is the bottom of the swimming pool, okay, there is a penny located at the bottom of the swimming pool. You look directly down from the air towards the bottom of the swimming pool. You see the penny appears to be somewhere here. So the bottom of the swimming pool appears to be somewhere here. Now we saw that before, right? But this is a new way of analyzing it using this equation. As a special case, and we know exactly where it is, negative N2 over N1 times P. So for water, N2 is about 1 point, and so for water, N1 is about 1.3, and N2, of course, air is 1. So Q is about equal to negative 1 over 1.3 times P. Now, we saw that before in a previous lecture, but this is a new way of looking at it. And a negative Q, again, means it's a virtual image. And which side of the image is it in? Well, we say it's on the wrong side. What does wrong side mean? Well, the term wrong side depends on what kind of material it is they're using to form an image. In the case of a mirror, okay, in the case of a mirror, let's say here's a mirror. This is in front of the mirror, this is behind the mirror. Now, a mirror is supposed to reflect light. Okay, it's supposed to reflect light. So, if it reflects light, the light converges on this side, which is at the same side as the object, that is the location of a real image, right? But if the image is formed on somewhere behind a mirror, where it's supposed to be dark, that, of course, must be a virtual image. So when I say the wrong side, in the case of a mirror, it means it's on the side that is not, it's on the wrong side, it's not on the same side as the object, okay? The object is placed in front of the mirror, and the image is formed behind the mirror, that is the wrong side, it's virtual. On the other hand, if it's a piece of glass, okay, if it's a piece of glass, you get an object on the front side. Now the glass is supposed to let light go through. It's refractive, right? So if you form an image somewhere behind the glass, that is the correct side because that's where light beam is supposed to converge. Okay, so the correct side in the case of glass is behind it. It's not on the same side as the object. Okay, but if the image is formed on the same side as the object, in the case of refraction, which is say a piece of glass, then it's actually the wrong side. Okay, now let's look at this case. Okay, this is just like glass is transparent, right? See, the image is formed on the same side as the object. That, in the case of a water or glass, is actually the wrong side. The image is not supposed to be on the same side as the object. That's not the case of a mirror. Okay, so that is why it's a virtual image, and that's why Q is negative. Okay, so let's keep that in mind. We understand what this negative sign inverted Q means.